Thank you very much. Good evening, good afternoon. It seems like it's already dark. I'm truly honored and privileged to be here. And I have this annoying habit of honoring a privilege by challenging the audience or challenging the authors or the initiators of the invitation. In the sense that I don't believe that it is really appropriate just to simply to come and repeat what we already know and accept and agree upon. So I would like to look for ways in which I can challenge without being offensive. I hope, at least that's my hope. Because I think it's important that we have the privilege of speaking to each other in this very civil, very deliberative environment, and we, for that privilege, we owe each other and our communities to challenge each other, to raise questions, to question our assumptions, and so on. With all due respect, again, thinking of Montesquieu and what he would think of me being here talking to you today, that is something that is I will hint at without saying too much about it, because I think we tend to speculate about, is he likely to agree or disagree, welcome my being here or resent my being here? And I have reason to wonder that way, having read his book in order to prepare for this lecture. And so it is really remarkable and a true privilege that I am here, whether he would have approved or not. And I am here to honor his work, but also to question it, or to honor it by questioning it, you might say. I'm also trying to honor Professor William Whittivin, because he has been the organizer and the initiator of this series of lectures. And unfortunately, with the tragic death of him and with his family over the Ukraine a couple of years ago now, I think, that raises the question of our inherent human vulnerability. That even someone like him who lived a lifetime trying to live with superior values, humane values, and to infuse those values in all the work that he does, and yet he and his family have to suffer such a tragic death. But I also take the incident and the tragedy as an indicator not only of our human vulnerability, but also about the limitations of the systems we work with for the protection of human rights and human dignity and accountability for crimes of war and so on. Because it's unlikely that the true perpetrators of that atrocious crime will ever come to account for it. And that also one wonders about, is it just that, I think it's a very good time to reflect and to consider what we might take from this tragic incident. The point also I would draw is, because I mean for him to have died and his family and so many other people to have died in that tragic incident, in this region, in this part of the world, it makes you wonder what is going on elsewhere, but it makes you also appreciate that all of us, if human rights are not respected everywhere, they cannot be respected anywhere. So we have to understand that none of us is immune, none of us is beyond the sort of contingencies of vulnerabilities of being human. When the Mahatma Gandhi, I think it's report, I don't know, I'm not sure, of course, if he said it or not, when the Mahatma Gandhi was asked about Western civilization, it's reported that he responded, "Sounds like a good idea." And I think I would like to borrow that sort of piercing insight and wit of the Mahatma Gandhi to say about human rights, it sounds like a good idea. And what I would like to raise with us here to reflect on is whether we have really truly honored that idea and advanced it in the last 60, 70 years or so since the University Declaration, or are we really wasting the possibilities and and the need, sort of failing to address the need and to remove the obstacles. If anything, I would like to suggest that we have added to the obstacles and that we seem to be pursuing a mirage of legal protection of human rights under the international law regime. And that we really need to think more fundamentally about possibilities of shifting the paradigm. Because I think the nature of what we now have invested in the protection of human rights is the regime that we have invested in, I would suggest, is totally and utterly incapable of protecting human rights anywhere, including in this continent. So that is at least the trend that I will, you know, to give you a sense of what where I'm heading with my remarks. The task that I see is, or the point I would like to suggest as my core thesis, you might say, is that I sort of claim that the state-centric, legalistic approach to the protection of human rights is incapable of delivering on that challenge. Not only that it has utterly failed already, but it tends to really create more obstacles in the path of the protection of human rights. And we have to remember, I think we are talking about protection, and actually one of the questions that we should ask is, what does protection mean? When we have a regime that can only talk about the need for protection without delivering that protection in concrete terms. So that is the primary task of these remarks, and then I will touch on other aspects that might be relevant to our conversation as well. As very much appropriately mentioned by the Dean about the refugee crisis that is now in Europe, and here I would like to suggest that the refugee crisis has exposed, I think, the collapse of the European front for the protection of human rights. Because refugees are really the true ultimate subjects of human rights. The point is that, of course, we have constitutional rights, we have legal regimes that protect various types of rights in various settings, but the idea of universality of human rights as the rights of the human, without any qualification than being human, no national origin, no race, no gender, nothing except just being human being. And then to consider, to what extent have we or are we capable? Now, my point is not just simply that we have failed, but that we could not possibly succeed without fundamentally challenging the international regime that we live with. Because now the point we see, a couple of days ago, European leaders meeting for a summit to try to aware to mediate, to reduce the challenge. But really none of them, and none of the people who speak of it, is rising to the level of the challenge and the occasion. Refugees, because they do not qualify for the protection of the host countries, and they cannot hope for protection of their countries of origin, are truly in a limbo. They are not benefiting from the traditional systems of international law, of state protection and state responsibility, neither the state which is where they happen to be now or the state from which they have flown. But the point is that since the structures and the concepts by which we seek to claim to protect human rights are necessarily state-based and centric, that they tend to suffer from the limitations of territoriality, and that every human being at every point in our lives have to be in some jurisdiction, that the nature of the globe, as has been now achieved through colonialism, is such that we have these notions of sovereign states which are in control of every single inch of land everywhere, so that human beings, unless we live in suspended animation sort of, we have to be somewhere. And the question is whether, wherever we are, the protection of our rights as human and for no other reason than our being human can reach us and can make the difference they need to make. Now, it is of course raised, and the point was raised already by some students I was talking to yesterday here in this school, about that there are obvious reasons why states are so hesitating and so ambivalent about what to do. Because states are responsible to their populations, and their populations are the ones who are telling them not to allow refugees in. And it is the populations who are saying that we cannot afford this, it's creating more destabilization and political challenges, and it might tamper with our culture, with our values, our lifestyle. And yes, of course, all of that is these are valid from a democratic point of view, that states should be responsive to the democratic demands of their own populations. But my point is why the populations are making those demands. So the failure is not the failure of European states. It is a failure of European peoples. That European, including us in this room, I should not include myself in it, but I would not accept to say that I am part of this. To see that, really, that when we have the bigoted, the stereotypical, the sort of everything that goes against the notion of the equal humanity of the other and the need for protection of the other, we have not responded sufficiently and appropriately to the causes of the flight of the refugees to begin with. And we are not now responding to the challenge of what to do about the people who are at our doors, the people who are among us, and they should have, if we are true to our commitment to human rights, they should be entitled to equal protection of their rights, just like national citizens and like lawful residents. Because at least the claim of being a refugee has to be honored. But when we look and see the nature of the international system and the international treaty that's supposed to regulate the status of refugees, we find that it's very inadequate. And in fact, the whole treaty regime, I would suggest, is inadequate. I don't think that it's capable. And as I try to clarify, that the nature of the law of treaties is intended for other types of obligations than human rights obligations. That I would like to suggest that human rights treaties are orphans, that they do not fit in the normal structure of the law of treaties, and they cannot be expected to be honored through that regime. So I think that the fact that we can understand why the European states are ambivalent, we can understand it, but we cannot condone it. Because it is not the state's fault. Of course, the states are just simply institutions that will deliver on the will and the political choices that the population of those states make. So it is, if there is someone at fault, it is the populations who are at fault, because they are refusing to acknowledge the equal humanity of the people who have come and traveled for reasons that we can understand, but we have not challenged. And we can talk about this, if you like, in terms of why did these refugees had to flee Syria, for example, or Libya or anywhere else in the first place. That it's not, nobody would flee their home country by choice. I have been through this myself in the 1980s. I had to flee Sudan, and I have lived outside Sudan since. But I would never have left if I had a choice. So this notion that people are fleeing by choice and that they are seeking a better economic situation is really a pretext to avoid to confront the fundamental moral question of our responsibility for the humanity of these populations. Now, you might ask, what has Montesquieu got to do with all of this? That is, in what way is Montesquieu's thought and life and work relevant to these questions? And I would like to suggest here that, of course, I mean, the notion of a smoking gun in terms of attributing particular views and particular consequences to particular authors is not really in the human experience. It's not possible to do that, and it is not very productive to do that. So I'm not seeking to indict Montesquieu personally. I'm sure that he was a very nice man for the time he lived, in the place he lived, for the class he represented, for the gender he enjoyed, and all of that. So, in other words, Montesquieu is a product of his environment, of his class, of his gender, of his entitlements and privileges that he enjoyed, and that is really a statement of fact. It is not a judgment that he was less of a human being or more of a human because of that. But the question becomes is, what have we done with what he had thought and spoke of? I'm not interested in trying to pin responsibility on him personally for what we are now suffering in the limitations of our paradigms and systems, but that what have we done with or without his work up to the present time? That is, there are ways in which all major intellectuals and philosophers like him would be contested, and people will always argue about what did he say, what did he mean by what he said. And the point is that whatever it is that we can conclude, that he has contributed to, that is the point I'm making. I'm not, as I said, interested in indicting him, but I'm saying that to the extent that he has contributed to the formation of European nation state systems, and which are bureaucratic, hierarchical, coercive, centralized, and that he has contributed to the notions of positive law, to that extent, he has contributed to the outcome that we live with. And it is that outcome which I believe is the fundamental barrier to the protection of human rights today. Because the whole point of universality of human rights are that they are more than the rights of the citizen. They are the rights of the human. And yet, when we have every other aspect of our systems focusing on the right of the citizen and the lawful resident, but not the rights of the human as human, then we have problems. So my point is that probably his work, as understood by Europeans for generations, have led to a self-understanding of Europeans that they have a mandate to go globally and project the values and the regimes and the system that he spoke of and other European Enlightenment philosophers spoke of as global standards. So I'm here suggesting that we cannot challenge or deny the reality of European self-understanding of a civilizing mission, that European armies, European navies have sailed out and tried to create situations where they would dictate to other people how they should live their lives, how they should structure their institutions, how they should organize their legal and normative systems. And that in doing so, we have created a global model that now is haunting us because of its limitations in protecting this fundamental value that we speak of. So it is that aspect of it. Without suggesting necessarily that he was personally, knowingly, as criminal lawyers tend to think, or intentionally intended that to happen, but that is, I think, is the outcome. Now, I do have some difficulties with his work, and primarily it is to do with, of course, as I say, he's a product of his time, his context, his class. Class is, I always keep saying class, because it's a very significant. In fact, the most significant thing about Montesquieu is his class. And having lived at a time when that class signified tremendous privilege and necessarily signified fundamental disadvantage and dehumanization for populations all around him. But what I'm saying about the difficulties of trying to retrieve something out of his thought, some of it has to do with is methodological, and some of it is probably a matter of style, which signifies sort of an attitude or a type of view of human beings and humanity. And of course, I don't have time to, I do have it all in the paper. Hopefully, we say inshallah, hopefully you will read the paper at some point. And you will see the quotations that I make and the evidence that I would try to present here. But as I say, because I'm not seeking an indictment, I'm trying to create a sort of a sense of where this has come from and where it is going. About the methodology, for example, there is the tendency to arbitrarily pick up examples from various cultures and epochs. He would cite something from the Roman and the Greek and jump to cite something from the Americas to go to the East. And so that I don't think that there is, and again, of course, I'm judging by today's standards of social science research and thought, in which that we tend to present coherent methodologies that will be defensible for their outcomes. But that factor is there, the factor of rather arbitrary selectivity. And that also, it's a view of law as a static and a given. That is, when he speaks about how our laws relate, or the laws of any society relates to the religion, the mores, the habits and even climate of peoples and communities, that may be true, but the question of human agency in the creation of law is absent. To my reading, I don't see it. I see just simply static, deterministic view of law that is due to these multiple factors. But the question of human choices that people make and human struggles, political struggles that people engage in order to promote sort of their well-being according to their own vision of who they are, I don't see that in his writing. But also that I sensed, and again, I'm sure that some of you have thought of this or some of you have had to refute it, I see a profound racism in his language. At some point, in the Spirit of the Laws, he speaks about, he says, if I am to defend the slave trade or slavery of the African populations, you know, the transatlantic slave trade, he says, if I am to defend it, this is what I would say. So that will imply that he's not really seriously, personally adopting the position. He's only speaking of it hypothetically. But to me, I think the level of detail to which he goes after making that disclaimer, you might say, and the language he uses in describing these unfortunate populations, and with all due respect, what I sense as the relish by which he is presenting these views is more than just simply someone who is hypothetically defending a position, which he did not need to adopt in the first place or to accept the charge of defending in the first place. And I wonder also why he focused on African slaves without thinking of other talking about other types of communities which have been subjected to slavery, including Europeans, for centuries. So slavery is not peculiarly African. And yet you find in the language, for example, when I said about language, there is a passage which I think I quote in the paper. He speaks about on the slavery of Negroes, and so he so gratuitously go on to expand. So because the subjects are blacks from head to toe. This is the translation of the most authoritative translation of the word, and you will find that it's quoted. That because they are blacks from head to toe, and they have such flat noses, that it is almost impossible to feel sorry for them. He goes on to say that it is impossible to us to assume that these people are men, because if we are to assume they were men, one would begin to believe that we are ourselves not Christian. Well, what does that mean? What is he saying? But I think whatever it is, I think it's offensive. And I don't think that it is just all justified or sort of dismissed by the hypothetical way that he formulated the question to begin with. Now, moving on slightly to present the title of my talk is to say that the spirit of laws is not universal. By that, of course, I'm referring, the phrase is very famous, I think, globally. Everybody, when you say the spirit of laws, people know exactly what author you are talking about, but that I'm saying that by its very nature, the spirit of law's doctrine and idea that he presented, it's an insight that he presented, indicates sort of diversity, not uniformity or universality. That every legal system, every system of laws is relative to the population, to the context, to the history, to the environment, and the various factors that he speaks of. So it is already self-evident there. But my point is beyond that, to say that the very premise of state and state-centric legal systems and the very premise of positive law of the state is not universal. It was not universal then, and it is not universal now. So if we are talking about universality of human rights, we have to take seriously the concerns of people who do not see their view of normativity and their view of life experience of political institutions in the systems that we are working with. So this goes back to my point about the European self-understanding of a missionary global sort of conquest in order to spread this highly intelligent and organized and systematic notion of the of legal systems. I think that the imperial European project, which sought to universalize the state system and the state-centric notion of legality, has come to sort of again be taken on at the moment of the emergence of the modern human rights doctrine and movement in the late 1940s. And here, of course, just to emphasize the point, we tend often, you know, as a student of this field since the 1960s, we were always taught that the American Declaration of Independence, the French Declaration of the Man and Citizen, even the Magna Carta, were human rights documents. No, they were not. Because none of those documents had to do anything to do with the rights of the human. They all dealt with the right of the citizen. And there is a major difference, because that's the whole point of my remarks so far, at least to emphasize that universality means inclusive, holistic, total universality of every human being, no matter which culture, which how flat my nose is or how dark my color of skin is, that this is the point. So it is this imperial project out of European Enlightenment that went about to present these views is what is really disturbing, and I think that we need to reconsider seriously. In his discourse in book number 9 and number 10, he speaks about the connection between commerce and conquest, and that imperialism can be justified in the promotion of peace and commerce, which is a very dangerous formula, if I may say so, because it dispels to me this, again, impulse to pretend that you are authorized to, because the question is, whose conception of peace and commerce, to whose benefit is the conception is going on? And again, it sounds almost neoliberal in the more recent sort of vein of the time that we live in. And here I would like to maybe jar your thinking a little bit by invoking Sayyid Qutb. Sayyid Qutb is the Egyptian ideologue of the Muslim Brotherhood. He did his work in the 1940s and 50s, and he was executed by Nasser in the 1960s, I think around 66 or so. Sayyid Qutb is really the father, the intellectual father of all the modern Islamist movement across the Muslim world and elsewhere too. And he made an argument for jihad, because Muslims like myself have always had a problem with jihad, and I cannot accept the notion of jihad as aggressive war, that you can just simply march off and coerce other people to embrace Islam and so on. So he argued that, no, this is not coercion. We are not imposing on other people. We are only engaging in this conquest in order, because the leaders of those societies are not permitting us to propagate Islam peacefully to their communities. So that to be able to propagate Islam in different communities, we need to sort of get rid of the leaders who are sort of creating obstacles to our access to their populations. Which to me sounds like also this notion about trade and peace or commerce and peace as a sort of rationalization of imperial conquest and so on. I don't know to what extent I should be careful here. Time is, it tends to sneak on you, as you can imagine. Let me move on to some remarks about what I think is the are the structural inadequacies of the current international system for the protection of human rights. So, because the point, the more important point to me is not a critique of Montesquieu and his language or his style or his assumptions, but it is that he may have contributed to the emergence of a system that other Europeans have perfected over the centuries and have used globally to impose their views and their choices and their economies and their interests on everybody else. The point is that when I said earlier about structurally, when it comes to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights 1948, adopted, proclaimed in Paris, the fact that really the physical voice of the vast majority of humanity was absent. That out of the 50 or so members of the United Nations at the time, there were only four African countries represented at the United Nations, and those were Egypt, Ethiopia, Liberia, and South Africa. The rest of Africa, which is now 54 countries, were absent. Not only absent, they were colonized by the same powers who were proclaiming the Universal Declaration in Paris. That the continuation of French colonialism in Algeria until the 1962 and the brutal suppression of Algerian resistance and Algerian demands for independence by the French who just emerged from Nazi occupation, only to repeat the strategies of Nazi, of collective punishment, of torture that the Nazis practiced on French people to do so in Algeria at the same time. So it is this history we do not forget. This history we will keep reminding people of. And until they are acting in accordance with an awareness of the consequences of that history, we will not stop making the points and so on. So I think that the nature of the regime is that I'm sure that there are many international lawyers here, so I shouldn't presume to explain too much about this, but simply to say that the nature of legal and treaty obligations is that they are among states between states. Only states have the legal obligation. Only states have the capacity to implement and to enforce that obligation. So that what we now talk about as non-state actors, even to think of who may have shot that plane over in Eastern Europe, over the Ukraine, it might be very difficult from an international law point of view to hold anybody accountable, because it could be a private crime, but to make it a human rights violation, it has to be attributed to a state. And which state will accept responsibility for that conduct, and what consequences can follow given our insistence on state sovereignty and immunities that we know in the nature of the international system, it's very unlikely that we can follow through with all of that. But in any case, the idea of enforcement of by subsequent response to the events is extremely inadequate. It's really trivial. With all due respect, to expect that we can really trace, and it is always after the fact. So human rights violations, I am from Sudan, I speak about violations in Darfur, in civil war with the South, in the North itself, and I speak of that out of personal experience. I was in prisons when this was going on next door and all of that. But therefore, I'm not saying that it is really the intention or the wish or the responsibility of European peoples and their states that they engage in these practices, but I'm talking about the nature of the international legal system, international state relations, that make it possible for these atrocities to be committed with impunity. And I hear, with all due respect again, to say that I am in the Netherlands, I realize, I know that I am really challenging a sacred cow. But I do not believe that the International Court of, Criminal Court is really making any difference or is likely ever to make any difference for the protection of human rights. The idea that we seek individual retribution against individual actors whom we are trying to investigate and convict at the highest level of evidentiary and procedural requirements, it is so refined, it is so idealistic, that it is very unlikely to be able to engage significant numbers of the vast thousands and hundreds of thousands of human rights perpetrators. It takes 10 years to achieve one conviction. But even that conviction has no way of impacting back into the, sort of filtering back into the situation of people on the ground. So what difference does it make for the civil war in Congo, or we call it civil war, I think, or just simply of the rape of women? What does it make to the recruitment of children that we pick someone and engage in a process that continues for years in order to achieve a conviction that never registers in the consciousness and the experience of people who are suffering those atrocities on the ground? And that it does not have an impact on the true, really, I mean, just to think about it and think, how is that likely to happen? But the most serious objection I have to the ICC is precisely the Western legalistic, positivistic notion of accountability. And here I will mention the example of Darfur again, since I am from Sudan, in that, of course, as the just one level of the limitations of the international system is that al-Bashir and the regime that he constructed and ruled through for 27 years almost by now, is committing these atrocities, killing hundreds of thousands of his own population in Darfur. The international community comes to the gate and knock and say, would you please allow us to get into your country so that they can stop you from killing your own people? That's exactly what happened. They had nothing, they were not willing to take the case to Chapter 7. They were not willing to commit troops and to engage in a sort of humanitarian law enforcement or international law enforcement in a way that can really be meaningful to the victims of those atrocities. But then you come and charge al-Bashir, who is a sitting president, with crimes against humanity, crimes of torture and other crimes, and he continues to be the sitting president for a decade after the charges are presented. And he's in a position, and he has done it. He has totally destroyed any evidence on which he can be convicted. So what sense would you have in terms of presenting charges at a time when you are incapable of arresting the accused, incapable of protecting witnesses, incapable of preserving evidence? It mocks the whole process itself. But the most ultimate objection to it, from my perspective, is that individual retribution dimension of it that has nothing to say about traditional African mechanism of reconciliation and going forward for communities to reconcile and to heal and to be able to live together. So what we have seen in Rwanda, what we see in Darfur, which is the reality across the continent, is that people would not care so much about punishing previous atrocities as they would care about creating conditions for peaceful coexistence and cooperation among communities going forward. To me, the traditional African notions of justice and accountability is much more profound, much more constructive, and much more able to truly preempt human rights violations rather than react to them in retrospect, than what the international community is capable of through something like the ICC. In my student days, and I continue to encounter this situation, is that the liberal relativistic view of rights, because we always have this talk about liberal values are human rights values, But everybody else's values are sort of cultural relativistic and really not universal. But I would like to suggest that liberal values are relativist too. There is no human being on this earth, no human being in this room, who is not relativist. We are all relative to who we are, where we're born, where our parents, what level of education we had, what level of employment we had, and all of these factors that influence the way we perceive the world and the way we decide and think about the values that we want to promote. So there is no neutral human being. We are all products of our cultures, our institutions, our values, and the religious and otherwise. So therefore, the notion that, so just to give a very brief example here, the notion of justiciability, that we were raised to believe that if it is not a right that you can contest by going to a court to have it enforced, then it is not a human right. It is not a right to begin with, and therefore it cannot be a human right, which is a relativist sort of liberal view, but can hardly address the concerns and profound worries of human beings around the world. There are no courts where you can contest rights to begin with. There are no legal systems. I lived in Sudan, I grew up in Sudan, we would travel for days without encountering a single policeman, let alone a court and a judge and an attorney or a lawyer who can represent you in these complex litigations. So it is really something that is suited for national legal regimes in the European mode, but not really appropriate for vast parts of the world elsewhere. And of course, economic and social rights are very difficult for liberals to conceive of as human rights altogether. And this is not history. This is still consistent with the European Convention of Human Rights, 1950, which does not include a single civil and political right, whereas the Universal Declaration itself concluded several. So the point, therefore, is about that relativity is a problem, a challenge to universality, but we are all implicated in relativity. And we should not really define the problem in a way that absorbs us from the difficulties of relativist values and tend to accuse the others of the same. Now, to go further to also, because I'm trying to highlight certain features of the current regime that we have and how it is really not conducive or capable of protecting human rights to the scale and speed that we need to have. Because the whole question is about jurisdiction, about state sovereignty, about the fact that the states cannot be coerced into ratifying human rights treaties, and if they do, they can enter reservations, even when reservations are not consistent with what the essence of the treaty is about. There is no political will in other states party to the treaty to contest the reservations of other treaties. So in other words, the treaty regime is premised on the fact that the various party states to the treaty have a vested interest in contesting each other's failure to comply with the treaty, including contesting the inappropriateness or the self-defeating notion of certain types of reservation that may be presented. But all of this happens in trade treaties, border treaties, tax, or any type of treaties where the states have a vested interest in the process. But for human rights, no state cares. That there are many states, including major Western powers, which totally repudiate the meaning of a treaty by the reservation that they enter, like the United States, which would not ratify most treaties that other states, I mean, as we know, the Rights of the Child Convention is only the United States and Somalia who have not ratified. But I'm not waiting for the United States to ratify because it's not going to make any difference because of the level of reservations that they enter for everything that they ratify. So these are the nature of the structure of the international regime that we have. But then coming to the aspect of the movement, and here I speak as a former director of Africa Watch because that was my experience. As an African who became director of Africa Watch, now Human Rights Watch, a division of Human Rights Watch, but at that time it was transitioning from being an autonomous entity to part of Human Rights Watch, that the point I saw it that my task is to make myself redundant. That is, I thought that the best thing that Africa Watch can do is to make itself redundant in the sense that the people whose rights we claim and pretend to protect should be able and capable of protecting their own rights, and that we should not be relevant to them to, so that we can come and protect them. But the point, I was told that this is foolish, it's not going to happen, we have to continue to protect these people's rights because they cannot protect their own rights, which to me is an ultimate insult. I mean, the point is that if they are unable, until they do, they are not going to be their human rights. But the point I'm talking about, what I call human rights dependency, which is the idea that northern-based organizations send delegations to monitor human rights violations in the South. We do not find delegations from the South coming to investigate human rights violations in the North. Are there no human rights violations in the North? Of course there are. But the process is not sort of mutual. The assumption is that the North is fine, the South is problematic. So we send delegations to monitor human rights violations in specific themes, particular locations, for 2 weeks, collecting information from local NGOs, and then we come back to London or New York to write our reports in English or other foreign, English primarily. That's Amnesty may publish in 7-8 months, sort of some translations. But the point is that the intention is not to report back to the population whose rights are being violated and whose, in whose name we claim to speak, but that they simply wait for our agency to move our governments, which are donor governments, so that they can insert political conditionalities and other types of mechanisms in order to make South governments accountable and so on. But the point is that nobody questions the underlying premise of dependency in the first place. Why is it that African states are dependent on northern aid and donor sort of goodwill all these decades after independence? Nobody is raising that question. Not only that, but in fact, that dependency is legitimized by pretending that the spectacle that we are using it to protect human rights, but we are not challenging it in itself. There is no challenge to structural relationships between global South and global North and other states so that we can create conditions where we can preempt human rights violations in those situations. I will conclude with just simply a note on a project that I'm trying to develop, which is I call decolonizing human rights. Because my claim is that the human rights field, conceptually, normatively, institutionally, has been colonized and continues to be colonized. That the institutions that are supposed to serve the system are not representative of global communities all over the world. That is, the universality of human rights, to my mind, should be reflected at the normative level, at the institutional level, at the political level, and all other levels, in the sense that it should be. So if I live in situations where tribal elders are more able to mediate and resolve conflicts and tensions over resources, avoid further violence among their communities, I need that to be acknowledged. I need that to be respected and incorporated, at least in dealing with my issues. But to bring the International Criminal Court to impose a totally alien and unrealistic, extremely expensive, and of course, who's paying for it? I know that the Netherlands is a major contributor, if not the primary contributor, probably. But I challenge all of this. And I will say that unless we really shift to a true sense of the accepting and respecting the human dignity of the other in all aspects, normatively, so it is not just simply about the ability to draft treaties in ways that we can say that our values are represented in them, which is not true for the Global South at this point, but also to say that our priorities for collective rights, for our priorities for intergenerational claims about the environment. So is it possible for a liberal mindset or a liberal institution to accept the possibility of contesting the environmental concerns intergenerationally in terms of future generations who are entitled to justice, who cannot yet contest these cases, cannot take the issue to a court to enforce. And nobody owns the right in a way that enables us to act accordingly. So these are multiple problems which ultimately come to this point about the challenge. And that challenge is about a state-centric system that's incapable of protecting human rights, and the answer is in our hands. Whether we go back to reinterpret Montesquieu or go forward and look somewhere else, we have to create conditions and normative systems that will be truly inclusive. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, I've been asked to briefly reflect on the excellent lecture by Professor Anaïm. But before I do so, I would like to take the opportunity to say what an honor it is for me to do so at the event of our Montesquieu Lecture, which was previously organized by our late colleague Willem Witteveen, very much missed in our academic community. As mentioned by our dean, Corinne Prins, Professor Anaïm was one of the first scholars and has remained at the forefront of issues such as intercultural dialogue and the need to negotiate between the universal and the local on behalf of tolerance and human rights. Issues that have only become more pertinent, especially also here in the Netherlands. And it's very much a privilege to have you in our midst here today. Also, on a more personal note, I had the opportunity to meet Professor Anaïm, I think it's about 25 years ago. Our paths crossed when I was working at the Netherlands Human Rights Institute and Professor Anaïm was a visiting scholar. I can imagine Professor Anaïm might not remember, but I very much do because the meeting left a lasting impression on me. So it's really an honor for me to have the opportunity to do this today. The lecture was an exploration of a number of concepts that seem to me to lie at the heart of the human rights predicament today. And Professor Anaïm does not mince words. I quote from the paper, which is really very much worth reading, and I hope you will. Professor Anaïm says, "The current legalistic state-centric approach has utterly and totally failed in providing any protection of human rights whatsoever." And Professor Anaïm also refers to the totally inappropriate means of so-called international protection. But in your paper, you don't stop there and you continue to suggest an alternative, a people-centered alternative to human rights protection. And I dare to say that this is characteristic for Professor Anaïm and his work. On previous occasions, Professor Anaïm has labeled himself as a pragmatic optimist, which is refreshing in a time when it seems very popular to declare that human rights have reached a dead end, as, for example, Eric Posner did last year. And I find the approach of Professor Anaïm much more constructive and most refreshing, because it's very easy to be a pessimist and not to come up with any solutions, but it's much more difficult to actually come up with constructive ideas. Well, the rich lecture and paper addresses several themes, and I distill two themes that I would like to react to, and that's the inadequacy of the state-centric approach and the need for, as Professor Anaïm calls it in the paper, a more people-centered alternative for enforcement. These are pertinent issues, also in my own field of research interest, business and human rights, and I see many parallels. I would like to pose three questions, or questions concerning the following three issues. Firstly, Professor Anaïm, you focus exclusively on the state and the relationship between citizens and people with their state. I would argue that there is actually a need to reconceptualize power beyond political power and to include economic power. The second issue I would like to reflect upon concerns the issue of enforcement of human rights and what we actually mean with enforcement. And thirdly, the proposal you do in your paper for an alternative to human rights enforcement, a people-centered alternative, also raises several questions of a rather practical nature. So let me start with the latter, the proposed people-centered alternative to human rights protection. Listening to Professor Anaïm, the famous words of Eleanor Roosevelt come to mind, one of the drafters of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. On the 10th anniversary of the Universal Declaration, she said the following: where, after all, do human rights begin? In small places, close to home, so close and so small that they cannot be seen on any maps of the world. Yet they are the world of the individual person, the neighborhood he lives in, the school or college he attends, the factory, farm, or office where he works. Such are the places where every man, woman, and child seeks equal justice, equal opportunity, equal dignity without discrimination. Unless these rights have meaning there, they have little meaning anywhere. Without concerned citizens' action to uphold them close to home, we shall look in vain for progress in the larger world. This is the point, I think, exactly stressed by Professor Anaïm in his lecture. The content and application of human rights should be determined by the people. It should be an inclusive concept realized in local context. If we look at the Universal Declaration, on its face, this declaration does not limit human rights obligations to states by stating in the preamble that every individual and every organ of society has a role to play in promoting and respecting human rights. Nevertheless, the premise of the document and the treaties that have followed since is that states hold the obligations when it comes to human rights. As Professor Anaïm pointed out in the lecture, imperial European nation state seems to have taken the model of state-centric legality as imperative for the realization of public goods and has forcefully demonstrated this state-centric approach frequently fails to protect human rights. I cannot but fully agree human rights should not be state-centric. They should be people-centered, a people-centered idea. Human rights should be about the empowerment of people. And that brings me to my first question of a rather practical nature, which I would like to invite Professor Anaïm to reflect upon. Because the question is how? How do we achieve a people-centered alternative to the enforcement of human rights? Of course, I don't think anyone can disagree with the need to put people at the center of human rights protection. It brings to mind the excellent work of Professor Sally Engel Merry, Professor of Anthropology at New York University School of Law. She addresses the interplay between local culture and transnational ideas and politics in the field of gender violence. And in her work, she demonstrates how challenging the intertwining of the local and global spaces in practice actually can be. So how do we avoid the participation of only the elite? How do we protect the weaker party against the stronger, more vocal party? And how and who will punish a breach of a human rights norm? The alternative Professor Anaïm proposes in his paper is an alternative to enforcement. And the matter of enforcement is the second issue I would like to address. As has been made crystal clear, the state-centric approach to human rights falls short of offering protection. And it's not difficult to find many, many examples of this. The refugee crisis was already referred to. But this does beg the question of what exactly is meant when we talk about enforcement of human rights. In your paper, you refer to the controversial and very problematic issue of humanitarian intervention. But enforcement surely doesn't only involve the use of force. Because isn't the human rights supervisory landscape more refined? Human rights are clearly under-enforced. But shouldn't we conceptualize enforcement in this field as a process of interaction, interpretation, and internalization of these norms? It is clear it goes beyond saying that the UN supervisory mechanisms suffer from serious shortcomings. But certain developments in the human rights supervisory landscape have, in my mind, started to make small but inroads into addressing some of the shortcomings of the state-centric approach. In light of the time, I will just mention a few of these developments, and I look forward to hearing the reflections by Professor Anaïm. Firstly, as is typical for law in general, human rights law is reactive. But we can distinguish certain preemptive developments. And in this respect, I especially would like to point out the work of the Inter-American System for the Protection of Human Rights, where we see that a lot has been done in the field of prevention, early warning, urgent action, and so on. Secondly, despite a lot of many flaws, we also see an increasing emphasis on participation by NGOs and individuals in the international supervisory mechanism. And as a commissioner at the National Human Rights Institute here in the Netherlands, I would also like to point out that layer of human rights supervision, national human rights institutions being a link between the national and the international level. And finally, returning to the idea of Montesquieu, among others, about the separation of powers, what about the role of the judiciary in the process of enforcing human rights? Well, be that as it may, I do fully agree with Professor Anaïm that the protection of human rights clearly leaves a lot to be desired. You point out the inadequacy of the state-centric enforcement paradigm and advocate a paradigm shift towards a people-centered alternative to the current state-centric approach. And in doing this, you focus on the relationship between the citizen and the state being both a protector and a potential violator of human rights norms. And that brings me to my final point, which concerns my own research interest, business and human rights. As I said, I would argue that we need to conceptualize power beyond political power to include economic power. Power has fragmented, and just to illustrate this point, the revenues of General Motors are more than the GDP of 148 countries. Walmart's revenues are larger than the combined GDP of all sub-Saharan Africa. These powerful corporations constitute a significant threat to human dignity. In other words, when we address the issue of human rights protection, shouldn't we move beyond the state? That raises a very fundamental question, whether in light of the problems posed by economic globalization, human rights actually is the appropriate language to be using. Have human rights, or can they actually, create a discourse that creates solidarity across borders? Let's take the example of the movement to improve labor conditions. A lot has clearly improved from the times when slavery was considered normal, and not that long ago, children were set to work here in European countries. But clearly, currently, the discourse of human rights is not yet persuasive enough to change corporate behavior, to persuade corporate actors to act humanely, and to improve the conditions of workers in other parts of the globe. You might wonder whether the language of human rights also connects us globally when it concerns challenges posed by economic globalization. Or should we conclude that there might be other languages of justice that might be more appropriate? In any case, if we do stick to human rights law, it is clear that the fragmentation of power forces us to further reconsider the boundaries between the public and the private. In fact, we can no longer maintain that only states can claim rights and discharge of obligations under international human rights law. Multinational corporations are already, in fact, participants in the international human rights system. Human rights are not only a concept or an idea, there's an increasing body, material body of legal decisions and cases, and corporations use the system. They use the regime of human rights. They don't take human rights as an idea. There are particular rules and regulations, principles of interpretation, and so on, that multinationals can and do go in and out of. Just think of the fact that corporations bring cases to the European Court of Human Rights claiming that their human rights have been violated. Thus, what I would argue, what I would advocate, is what we really need is a paradigm shift regarding the duty bearers on the international human rights law. There's a need to include corporations as bearers of human rights obligations. Finally, if we look at the field of business and human rights, I see an interesting parallel with what with the call of Professor Ananim to move beyond the state-centric paradigm. It is in this field that we can witness a careful move away from traditional international law solutions towards what may be called experimental governance or polycentric governance. This refers to the coexistence of several different regulatory regimes around the same issue without a clear hierarchy, where no one entity holds the sole rulemaking power. We increasingly see initiatives aimed at regulating corporate impact on human rights, and it involves many different actors, both in the design of the regulation and its supervision. And it sometimes does not involve the state. But it does include those that are the object of the regulation, corporations themselves. Okay, so this brings me to the end of my reflections, and I think I've already taken up quite some time, so I look forward to hearing the reactions by Professor Ananim. Thank you again for your lecture, and I look forward to the discussion also with the audience. Thank you.